Good morning and welcome to East Union this morning. I'm Dave Coons and I'm here to welcome you all both here in person and online. Welcome to guests in both locations as well. And we'll talk about the announcements. Sunday, October 1st, we got World Communion Sunday, and there's a Mennonite Women meeting on October 4th, October 3rd. October 4th is the Harvest Party at the Geyers at 6 p.m. I understand from last week they are in need of apples as well for their cider press. You can see the address and announcements in the bulletin. Then a big town hall meeting and annual report on October 18th, following a potluck. And then our annual luncheon at East Union, call to worship then. We gather here in anticipation, seeking an encounter with our holy God, who comes among us when we least expect it, who invites us to wrestle with our questions and doubts, who richly blesses us and calls us each by name. Let's worship God together.
Hello, everyone. Yes. Let's stand for our gathering hymns this morning. We're going to sing three old good hymns, the first of which is Gott ist der Liebe, I Know God Loves Me, out of the Voices Together, number 158. Stand if we're able, let's raise and join our voices to the Lord. How about D? We're singing in English. We sang in German yesterday, but we'll sing in English. But if you want to sing in German, we can do that later after the service.
I know God loves me with love unending. I know God loves me, for God is love. And so I sing the hymn of how God loves me. I know God loves me, for God is love. Though sins are around me, my love is sung. Sins around me are helping still, and so I sing the hymn of how God loves me. I know God loves me, for God is love. God sent us Jesus, our faithful Savior. God sent us Jesus to set us free, and so I sing the hymn of how God loves me.
Is number 619, number 619, In the Rifted Rock I Am Resting. 619.
Now I'm resting.
final song of gathering is number 47, God of Our Strength. It's a Fanny Crosby song, text written by Fanny Crosby. And I know that Vern is a very, very fond of the songs of Fanny Crosby. So. Number 47, God of Our Strength, low E flat.
God of Enthroned Above, the source of life, the fount of love, oh, let the ocean sacred flame, our souls away to praise thy name.
Now it's time for dedication of gifts and offerings. As you know, there are several ways to give. You can give at the back of the church in the basket there, online. You can mail it to the church as well. And there's also Vanco Mobile. So let's pray over our offerings. Jesus of love and leftovers, we struggle with what to share and how much is enough. Sometimes we are the disciples quietly suggesting you send the needy crowds away. Sometimes we are the crowds, bringing only our desire to be close to you. When we have little, embolden us to share it. When we have nothing, welcome us to stay and eat. In giving and receiving, we participate in the miracle of enough. Thank you, Jesus.
Good morning. Hello. I said, good morning. And I said, I bet you guys had to wake your mom and dad up early so they wouldn't forget to bring you to Sunday, to church and Sunday school. Today, we're going to talk about a story of someone who wrestled. Do you ever wrestle with anyone? Oh, I see a few hands. And we're going to talk about two kinds of hurt. One kind of hurt is when our bodies get pinched or scraped or broken. I remember someone here had a broken leg not many years ago. Reed, you had a broken leg, didn't you? Oh, wait. Yeah, here's Reed. I was looking at Simon. Yeah. Is that broken leg all better now? Oh, that's so good to know. Sometimes there's another kind of hurt. When someone says something mean, or when someone takes something and just grabs it away from you and won't give it back, do you hurt inside when that happens? Yeah. Have you ever had a fight with a brother or sister? Oh, yes, you know something. Even the big people in back have had that happen, even when they're little and when they're big. But sometimes we can find ways to say, I want to make it better. I'm sorry. And is it sometimes fun when things are better again after a fight and you can play fun things together again? Yeah. Well, today we're going to hear a story about two brothers who didn't get along so very well. Last week, we learned about Abraham and Sarah, and they had a baby. Does anyone know, remember, what was that baby's name? Lucas, you should know. What was that baby's name? Abraham and Sarah had a Isaac. Yes, that baby's name was Isaac. And Isaac grew up and he was a big man and he got married to Rebecca. And guess what? They had two boys. They had twins. Do any of you know twins? You know any twins? Do you? Cousins? And some that go to your school? Awesome. Some other ones that go to your schools. Lisa? Friends that are twins. Well, the problem with these twin boys was one of the boys, Jacob, he took something that was his brother's. And he shouldn't have done that. And it made his brother very angry. And these boys were big men now. And his brother was really mad. He wanted to hurt Jacob. Now that's not a good thing, is it? No, I don't think so. And so Jacob decided he wanted to be okay. He wanted to be safe. And he decided he's going to go a long way away and he's going to stay with his uncle. And he did. He's a big man. He went away. He stayed with his uncle. He got married and he had kids. And he had lots of animals. He had lots of goats and lots of sheep and lots of cattle and lots of donkeys. He even had camels. Camels! Imagine that! Yes, you sit right here. He had camels, and he decided after many years that he wanted to go back, and he wanted to see his brother that he had been so upset with. He wanted to go see his brother. He kind of missed him, but he was very far away. So he told his wife and all his kids, he said, "Pack up all your things. We're going to go visit my brother." Now, the funny part is, he took, you help hold it for me, okay? He took all his cattle, all his animals with him. When you go on vacation, does your dad, do you know any farmers that take their animals with them? I don't. But he was going to move. And so he was going to take all of his animals with him. And the women and the children, guess what they rode on? They rode on camels. They rode on camels, and they went to find his uncle. When they got kind of close, Jacob's thinking, I don't know if my brother's going to be happy with me. He said, I don't want my brother to be unhappy with me, so I'm going to take some goats and sheep and cattle and gold and silver, and I'm going to send it with my servants to go before me. And he did that. They did that. And then it was nighttime, and Jacob hadn't gotten there yet, and he said, I'm so tired. I want to lay down. But before he was asleep, felt in the dark like there was this something wrestling with him. If you're in the dark and you're wrestling, you can't really see who you're wrestling with, can you? Well, I wonder who Jacob thought he was wrestling with. He wasn't sure, but he was asking for something special. He was asking for a blessing. And near the end of the wrestling, in the almost morning, whoever he was wrestling with said, "I'm going to change your name. I'm going to change it from Jacob to Israel." And then Jacob knew who he was wrestling with. Do you know why he knew? Because Israel means I struggled with God. And Jacob knew that it was God he was wrestling with. It was God. So today, we're going to have a little bit of, we're going to have a prayer, and then I have something to send back with you. You know, sometimes we do wrestle with God. Sometimes we have questions. There are things we aren't sure about. But God wants us to know, I'm here with you. I'm here with you. And that's what he wanted Jacob to know. As Jacob was going to his brother, God wanted Jacob to know, I'm here with you. I'm here. You're not alone. Let's have a little prayer. God, thank you so much for being with us all the time. Even when we don't know we need you, even when we don't know for sure where you are. And thank you for forgiving us When we get angry with someone and when we're sorry, we know that makes your heart happy. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I have a little bag with two things in it. And Elise is going to help me toss them out. There are Band-Aids, fun Band-Aids, for the scratches that we get. And there's a candy heart to help us remember to be kind.
Right. Now for the scripture reading of that story. Comes from Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 through 30, and this is the NIV version. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared."
Good morning. It is good to be worshiping with you here at East Union and online this morning. I have a friend who wrestled competitively at Iowa State in the early 2000s. And last year he helped at middle school with coaching. He was an assistant coach and he was explaining different moves. And I just realized, like, I had no idea what language he was speaking, right? Like all these holds and escapes, all these different ways to overtake your opponent, talking about how to cut down angles and tricks to get on into a certain position. I've never fully understood wrestling myself. I don't know, maybe you're a big wrestler or wrestling fan. But in Iowa, wrestling is actually a really important sport. Universities of Iowa and Iowa State have been very successful over the years. But the extent of my knowledge is probably that Dan Gable was a really good wrestler and he coached Iowa for a number of years. So, and I've wondered at times, you know, wrestling is probably not the sport that Mennonites gravitate towards, or not in Mennonite circles. It looks a little bit too much like active combat. Two persons of relatively equal size grappling with each other, trying to throw one another to the ground, grunting. In football, at least, you have this large helmet that covers up your face so you can't see the grimaces or the impact or the pain that's happening. But here you have just two people in the ring, in the circle, trying to take each other. And riding time is crucial for eking out a win. I don't know why, but it is. Now, I may not know much about college wrestling, but I do know a little bit about wrestling, the wrestling that goes on in our hearts and minds. You know what I mean? Have you ever wrestled with a tough decision? Have you ever wrestled with understanding scripture or connecting with God, feeling like God is far away? I've talked about it quite a few times over the years, but a significant time of wrestling for me was when I went into teaching. When I first went into teaching, I went to college. It seemed like a no-brainer. You're guaranteed a solid income. You have the summers off, right? That's a great thing. And you get to impact young students' kids' lives.
And what I found when I went to school was that I was pretty successful in classes. Like, I knew the content well. I could understand, you know, what we were supposed to do, what the intent was. I was pretty good at practicum experiences. Like, we often got into the classroom and did short lessons for teachers. They would give us a time slot and maybe some material that we were supposed to go over, and I could do that well. Student teaching was great. I did it at Parkside and Goshen, and I love my coworkers. I love the principal. I love the students. I did well. In fact, I may have said this before, but I think it's when Christine decided that I was an okay guy, because when we went one time, she stopped by and visited, and all the students said, "Mr. Beachy," you know, and came running over to me and really, you know, buttered her up for me, right? But then I got into the classroom. 3 years of desperate struggling. It didn't matter how much I planned, what kind of activities I chose. I always felt like I was behind. I always felt underprepared. I vacillated between trying to create a warm and lighthearted environment in the classroom to yelling and threatening simply to get some sort of order established. And it was at the end of my second year of teaching in Meridian that I found myself needing to take mental health days away from the classroom just to make it through to the end of the year. When one fails at something, you know, spectacularly fails at something, whether it's as a kid in school, whether it's a job, whether it's a relationship, or any other moment in your life, it is hard. And you have to wrestle. And that wrestling happens on the inside. Your emotions, your feelings. One may begin to wonder about who they are. Like, who are you really? Like, when your job no longer defines you, who are you? What are you called to do? Who are you called to be? Those kinds of questions, when we wrestle with them, they are hard. The story of Jacob in Genesis also offers us an inside view to someone who is wrestling internally. Karen shared the story, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about it. Because Jacob really is, he's a complicated person. Despite there's this clear, strong connection between Jacob and God, but his life is full of chaos. Jacob regularly engages in deception. And it has consequences for him. Much of his life does not reflect the qualities of what one would call a life of faith. It's not a life that we would probably adopt or try to mimic. As Karen shared, Jacob was a twin, and his brother's name was Esau. And even in the womb, Jacob and Esau jostled with one another. Maybe they were wrestling. Maybe it was a precursor to the wrestling that Jacob would do in his real life. And Rebecca is told that within her womb lie two nations. These two nations are going to be separated from one another, and they're going to be at odds with one another, and one will be stronger than the other. And in fact, the older sibling will have to honor the younger one, contrary to the cultural norm. And these two brothers, Jacob and Esau, could not have been more different from one another. Esau is big, strong, hairy. He liked to hunt. He went out on long treks to find wild game. And his dad, Isaac, preferred him because of that, right? He was the manly man. He favored Esau. He had the same interest and loved to eat the wild game that he brought back. Jacob, on the other hand, was a little bit softer, a little bit milder, maybe a little bit more refined. Stayed closer to home. He helped out with the cooking and the gathering, or maybe the gardening, and he was closer to his mother. But there's something else about Jacob that made him stick out or stand out from his brother. He was cunning. He was the cunning one of the two, the more devious as well. For while Esau was out hunting game, Jacob was trying to figure out, well, how do I get access to all this that my parents have? And he worked with his mother to decide how to best do that. And so when one day Esau comes back from a long, you know, journey to hunt, he's famished, he needs to eat immediately, can't wait even 15 minutes. And so Jacob takes the opportunity and asks him to sell his birthright for a bowl of stew. Now, birthright, as we might imagine, is the right of the firstborn. In some cultures, even in our own, oftentimes, right, the elder is given sometimes a little bit preferential treatment when it comes to decisions about who takes over the family business, or who's going to purchase the farm, or who's going to access a piece of the inheritance. And on some levels, this makes sense, right? Like, you know, we might want to say, oh, no, that's not quite fair, but we want to have it equal. But in some ways, it makes sense, right? The eldest is often the person who has to take more responsibility earlier on in life, right? Care for the other kids. Who's going to take care of the sheep to the watering hole? Who's going to help pull up the stakes and move the tents when it's time to move on? Who's going to drive their younger brother or sister to school? The added responsibilities of being the eldest are rewarded then. They're given special rights. And in the case between Jacob and Esau, Esau sells this right to his brother for some soup because he's hungry. And you might think, you know, this is a low-down thing to do, taking advantage of your brother at a weak moment to gain the upper hand, but it gets worse. It's even worse than that. Because later, Jacob even deceives their father, their aging father, pretending to be Esau, and steals his brother's blessing from their father. The father's nearly blind. He can't hear very well. He can't see very well. He's somewhat bedridden. And so Jacob puts on his brother's clothes, puts on some hairy goat skins, makes some food, and goes to his father and pretends to be Esau and steals a blessing from him. Jacob doesn't seem to be the kind of person one would want to model their life after. In fact, later on, Jacob flees his brother to go to his uncle Laban's, and that's where he marries these two daughters, and he begins to amass wealth. And it's in working for his uncle that he uses some advantageous animal husbandry, right? He does these things to increase his flocks, and he dupes his uncle out of most of his livestock. So let's just recount just a little bit, right? He steals his brother's birthright. He steals his brother's blessing. He flees home, leaves his parents, leaves his family, sneaks off, goes to work for his uncle, takes his two daughters, and takes most of his uncle's wealth. Then what does Jacob do? Well, he's got enough wealth. He doesn't need his uncle anymore, so he sneaks off in the night. He's afraid that there's going to be the conflict. He already has what he needs. Let's get out of town. And so he heads out, decides, well, you know, it's been enough years. I'm going to head back home, try my chances there. But he's still nervous about how he's wronged his brother. He knows, I ripped him off. I took what was his. And so as a last-ditch effort, he starts to decide which of his things he could sacrifice, put in front of his brother in case he's angry still. And it's at that point, at that night, that Jacob sleeps alone, sends his family away, and spends the night alone, preparing himself, waiting to meet his brother, whom he had wronged, and go see him in the morning. And so this sets the stage for this encounter. And in this story, Jacob wrestles. And I think Karen did a very nice job of helping us to think, is this a physical wrestling? Is this an internal wrestling? Jacob wrestles with this man, and in this contest of strength, Jacob and the man are equally matched. Just as if they both cut weight and they weighed each other and they were both in the same class and they're able to go at it. And they're equally matched. And so the men, they can't gain an advantage over one another. And they wrestle all night long and they hold each other and neither one can escape. And it's at this point that the other man wrenches the socket of Jacob's hip to gain some sort of advantage and to escape. But Jacob holds on tight, and it's at this point that Jacob asks for a blessing. And you have this exchange where this man says that your name shall no longer be Jacob, but it'll be Israel, for you have wrestled with God. So maybe Jacob's life is not one to hold up as a model. But what I think this story shows to us or helps us see is that what his life does show is everyone is worthy to be redeemed, even the scoundrels among us, even if we're that scoundrel. It also demonstrates, I believe, how each of us can wrestle with God at some points in our lives. And that we don't need to be afraid of that struggle. God can handle when we mess up, when we get it wrong. The important thing is that we allow God to engage with us, work in us. Let God wrestle with our emotions, with our questions, with our insecurities, with our doubts. God even lets us wrestle with him. The one thing that Jacob does that is right is that he does not hide away. He engages God, and he is changed for it. I shared about teaching, but in my life, I've wrestled with all sorts of things. I'm sure you have too. And I realize that despite all of my failures, all of your failures, even the places where you've schemed or I've schemed or dealt in bad faith, God can mend those broken places in you. God can mend those broken places within you. For God knew who Jacob was, and he forgave him anyway. God already knows who you are. God knows you. You can't trick him. God knows who you are, and God knows the places where you fail and the places where you show courage. The important thing is to not hide away. Again, if there's anything to model after Jacob, it is to not be shy when it comes to God. Let God change you for the better. Let God rename you and claim you for his own. And maybe one step further, if God can do that with you, then even more you should be able to do that with yourself. And when you wrestle with who you are, maybe knowing how gracious God was to Jacob will help you be more accepting of yourself, able to forgive your own sins. In 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 to 9, it says, "If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. However, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us. Will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." This is our wrestling mat. This is where we meet our opponent in the battle of self-deception. If we imagine that we are without sin, we deceive ourselves. However, if we allow ourselves to be vulnerable and to wrestle with the turmoil within us, our inability to do what we ought to, right? Then we may be forgiven. God forgives. And what a glory to let go of the shame and the guilt of every time we mess up. And if God can do that for Jacob, and God can do that for you or for us, then all the more reason for for us to extend grace and forgiveness to each other, to others. East Junior, may we better learn, like Jacob, how loved we really are. May we not be afraid to wrestle with God. May we learn to live out the kindness and compassion that God offers to each of us. May it be so.
Let's stand, if we're able, for our song of response to Joel's message. It's based on the passage, the scripture passage that was focused on today, Genesis. Number 191, Voices Together, O Come, O Thou Traveler Unknown. This is a might be a new song. It's an older song, but it might be a new song to some of us. We'll sing verses 1 and 2 in unison on the soprano, on the melody, and then we can break into parts of verses 3, 4, and 5. 191, Voices Together. Applaudi.
Generation of recognition. reconciliation and peace. Let us be a holy nation where pride and prejudice shall cease. Let us speak the truth in love to the lost and least of these. Let us serve the Lord in unity so others will believe. Let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. Oh, let us be generation of reconciliation and peace. Let us build on one foundation till he comes and the wars of men shall cease. Let us share the love hypocrisy. Let mercy and forgiveness begin with you and me. Let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. Have we not
number 841 in Voices Together. As you go out from here, we'll sing through it twice. Ooh, that's not right. As you go out from here,
the Lord will bring you the face of God. Shine on you every day. Be comforted by God. Wherever we are living, salt and earth and people of the way. As you go out from here, may the Lord go with you the face of God. Shine on you every day. We are sent by God. Wherever we are living, salt and earth and people of the way.
Just a reminder that we do have adult Sunday school classes for folks. If you want to join the kitchen class down the fellowship hall, that is an option. And now receive this benediction blessing. Beloved, Jacob wrestled with God's angel and prevailed. In honor of his persistence, God gave him a new name. We ask God to teach us to persist in the face of struggle and call us by name. Amen. Go in peace.